CFO Conclave 2013, a series of panel discussions examining some of the most pertinent issues faced by CFOs today, enters its penultimate phase. In this edition of the Conclave, CFOs from different industry verticals discuss the issue of dealing with regulatory uncertainty in a weak economy.
Let me start off with you. The worst word in tax parlance or any kind of legal framework is retrospective, which is really, you know, the bane of a crisis that we are facing right now. What have the ramifications been? And when you talk about regulatory uncertainty, I think the big R is the first thing that you have to address.
I must say that our position has consistently been that anything that is retrospective is retrograde. That is clear in our minds. The impact that all of these retrospective changes have had is it has disturbed the confidence of the international investor in India. And I think the government today is visibly in search of a way to backtrack on something that has already been released into the system and has become a genie that they can't control. So therefore, that is the good news, that at least there is a sense of wanting to trace the wrong steps back. And I welcome that. And I think if you have taken a stand which you realize is not appropriate, there's no harm in going out and saying that this needs to be reversed. Mm. And I respect that as intellectual honesty.
Transfer pricing has created a real fear factor, no. Not only in the kind of headlines that we've seen around India in terms of regulation, it also has manifestations in the domestic companies which are getting more complex in their businesses. And my question to you is in that, from now, and it's only been recently included in the transfer pricing ambit, but domestic companies also come in. There is clear fear among CFOs about what this really means. What is the kind of litigation it opens up? How far back will they go in the books? What is going to happen? What is the kind of query that you've got from CFOs?
Original Transfer Pricing International was introduced in 2001. By that time, the tax officers were also on a learning trend. Now they are far more equipped to deal with this situation. And now we have introduced domestic transfer pricing legislation, which has caused a fear because today you have up almost 50,000 crores of adjustments, which is the highest, not just all over the world, that India has, which puts to that how do you deal with this uncertainty? Let me give you one example. Say we have a colleague from GMR. It's doing a power project and you're claiming ATIA, which says you cannot claim excessive expenditure. If it's excessive profits, I'll not give you the benefit. And then you have another group company which gives a group cost, which cannot be also excessive. So if you go down, you are attacked. If your profit is more than the required, you are still attacked under ATI. So you cannot go down, you cannot go higher. Today, even if I ask our colleague to predict what is the arm's length profit, and I will do that, it's impossible to say exactly I will earn only 10%. So if you are down, you are attacked by domestic transfer pricing. If it's higher, you're still attacked. So how do you deal with this situation is a fear that most the corporate have, that if there is an, and today in international transfer pricing, there is a mechanism to resolve. That is, you can go to APA and get it done. But that is right now valid only for international transfer pricing. For domestic transfer pricing, if I want to say, look here, taxman, I'm ready to pay whatever tax that you want. Why don't you ascertain and tell me what is the tax? Today, there is no way that I can go out and resolve, I'm ready to pay whatever tax, but I don't want a dispute. Please tell me what is that.
How do you see this? Is this part of the evolutionary phase where we get integrated with complex issues like transfer pricing? How do you see it panning out?
Let me give you the perspective of transfer pricing. Transfer pricing is a matter which is going to take some more time because it is more of a psychological issue. But any psychological subjective issue converted to a measurement is a big thing. And if a taxman says that a subjective matter I'll be able to measure with an objective tool, it's difficult.
Okay. That's a wonderful introduction to transfer pricing. But my question to you is that basis of most of the litigation seems to be a distrust in the way in which the transfer pricing has been calculated and the subjectivity which is involved at both ends. How do you deal with these two you know, issues which are not really, you know, manageable.
To me, it boils down to two words, documentation and research. These are the two crucial things which drive your ability to defend a transfer price. If you have your processes, your whole business process mapped, documented, just as doctor was saying, if you can make sure that you can prove that this element belongs here in this silo and the other element belongs there, and you can document it and you can prove it to the transfer pricing authority that that is how it should be viewed, then the dispute settles. It is because we are on a very steep learning curve on how to actually document business models that we are having this whole huge plethora of disputes in transfer pricing. As we start doing this, and as we do good research, and databases and all of that are becoming available in the world, to make sure that you don't do it out of your own assumptions, but you do it out of some objective, validated basis. As this becomes more prevalent, we will see the disputes coming down. And I see them coming down. Okay.
Mini, I would like to give a rejoinder to Shailesh. She is one word. That if you do documentation and bring in activity-based costing and say that here the cost is more, so profit should go, from the perspective of giving a taxable adjustment of the cost, not true. What has to be understood from the context of transfer pricing is also to the extent that who has given you the intellectual property and value addition to that. You have to do a measured value of that and bring it to the cost.
That's the whole business model.
Then the fear of profit getting more tax than the cost not getting adjusted will go away.
Okay, Himal, will the APA regime improve the situation, restore confidence, and also have an impact on existing litigation on ground where once the rulings start coming?
So I see APA as a definite positive step. It is helping restore. And just to give you numbers, so there were more than 165 applications, pre-filing applications filed, out of which 140 go into main application. And just for the reference, pre-filing is a stage where you have a consultative process. If you are got that level of confidence, you file the main application. So out of 165, if 140 have gone in main application, that itself shows that there is a lot of confidence of the corporates in the mechanism. And government is also out there to prove a point. So I think the APA will do well in its own sense. The only thing I wish that will not happen and should not happen is the way we went down the AR route. So AR was supposed to be binding, not appealable. But now you see appeal being filed in High Court, you have Supreme Court. We had the same thing in DRP. DRP was introduced, this will resolve all the conflicts. Once the order is passed, it's binding on the assessing officer. So we said, good initiative, kill the litigator. Then you introduce that, no, now DRP is also appealable. So the only thing, a word of caution here is APA, yes, good, but we should not be seeing any turnaround where it says that, oh, we agreed on a binding thing, but by the way, now it is appealable, so you go down the High Court.
The larger and deeper concerns, especially in the infrastructure area and in the securities market, that need to be addressed, because I think that's holding back the country. Let's start off with infrastructure. The two aspects to it, since you look at the money raising for GMR as a group, which is really the fact, on one hand is the regulatory uncertainty in pretty much everything that has got to do with infrastructure, and airports is a case in point. I think your existing battle with the regulator on tariffs based on which you actually set up a project which is had a 99-year lease has been in question. The second is, what does that mean to the investors that you go and try and tap into? Because what they're hearing out of India is only this, negative news. So it becomes extremely difficult for an infrastructure company, from my mind, to go and actually give a business case for investment.
Today, as a CFO, all of us now recognize that uncertainties are going up. Regulatory uncertainties are going up worldwide. And there can be many reasons for that. There can be political reasons, there can be the economic reasons. And you are coming out with newer factors all over the world, particularly when the companies are multinational. Now, as far as the Indian scenario is concerned, please appreciate that till 95 or 96, most of the infrastructure projects were done by the government itself. Then we started a new concept called PPP, public-private partnership, which means introduction of the private players to the infra sector. Now, in case of power sector, regulations were formed. In 2000, total capacity of India was close to 1 lakh megawatt. Today, we have close to 2.15 lakhs megawatt. So because of the introduction of private sector, in last 12, 13 years, capacity has become double, more than that. When the first regulations were formed in close to 1998, and then it was modified in 2003, those regulations have taken the country forward for next 10 years. Today, we are already talking about the new regulation for power sector. SCB Health is being discussed, new bidding documents are being talked now. So we believe that this is the time for relook at the regulations, relook at the policy documents, which will take India again for next 10 years, 15 years.
My question to you is that most infrastructure companies, because of the delays, are also facing a cash crunch, a money crunch. Now, when you go to investors, how are they viewing this situation?
Today, instead of discussing the investment in the infra company in India, they only talk about India macro and the issues which Indian infra companies are facing, particularly on the business side. So they only, they talk about the coal, the gas, the all the issues. Then they talk about the leverage of the group, and then they talk about the going forward, what the process. So yes, this is a challenging time, and the only solution which we have seen in the last few years is constantly getting engaged with the regulatory authorities in respective sectors, with the policy makers, and trying to impress upon them with both pros and cons, and hope that some of the requests which you make will be accepted.
Let me come to you. From the regulatory perspective, I think our markets, the securities market, have been very well regulated. They've been in the forefront of a lot of the innovation. Mm-hmm. But one can also argue that it's great regulation, but there are a lot of implementation issues that need to be addressed. So in terms of, is regulation alone enough? Or do you need clarity and actual action on the ground also in some cases?
People who actually create a regulation, many a times they do not have full knowledge of the facts on ground. And that's why what happens is that after regulation comes in, then there's some rejoinder comes, some press releases come, some circulars come after that. And it all leads to more confusion for anybody who is actually acting on those regulations. And this is a problem across industries, not only securities industry. What I have found, observing all these businesses which we have been working on, is like this, that because of this uncertainties, business community and our own broker members, these guys are now totally deluged with compliances. And with so many brokers I have been talking with, it's not a matter of only BSE, it also applies to NSE guys. So, first of all, there's some uncertainty regarding how it will be enforced by exchanges, then how it will be enforced by regulator, how it will be enforced by government officials, tax officials, and so many other layers of enforcements. And then comes that, then the main trouble is economy itself. You have to, survive all the this regulations and then do business. And again, the business economy, if the economy is not that good again, they suffer.
In your context, when you are working as an NBFC, you're also working parallelly with other systems, the banking system, the NBFC segment. There are multiple avenues within it. How complex is it for you, and what is the biggest hurdle that you face?
Today, if you see that top 6-7 NBFC in India is managing almost 2 lakh crores of the assets. So that's a good sign. And HDFC Limited is an NBFC managing more than 2 lakh of the assets in itself. But the point is, during this period, a lot of different nature of the activity has been started by the NBFC, which may sometime in a direct conflict with the banks, because banks has also started doing the same. Regulator being same, here there is a need whom you want to prosper or whom you want to, let's say, give the way to grow on that. When you are consolidating the NBFC, the capital of the NBFC, the earlier it used to be a 10% increase to 15%, just to weed out the smaller player in the NBFC. So today what is happening, and that's what the more confusion is coming, the regulatory control which are being, let's say, imposed or being searched on the NBFC is completely in the line of the banks. That's a good to some extent, but at the same time, if you are start playing the level playing field, then it makes much more sense. Let me tell you some of the ground reality. NBFC and banks, when both are in the same sector, what is the role of NBFC? NBFC is typically going to the customer who does not have that level of documentation which bank can give them the loan. So let's say I have a local setup, I understand the strength and weakness of the customer, maybe he do not have that certain level of the document. We are willing to finance this guy. He does not have a salary income, he does not have a business. Bank may hesitate to do that. But because that's a risky business, I will charge a little bit more risk premium. And that's what the arbitrage is available for NBFC, because banks do less risky business, less risk premium. If that is what the reason of the NBFC sector, I think the rules has to be put in line with that.
In the last couple of a year and a half, you've seen the MFI segment collapse. We've seen, again, the whole Sharda Chit Fund and the entire unbanked segment come up. My question to you is that on one hand, you have a very heavy regulatory framework. On the other, you have a parallel network that is actually creating a huge crisis in the unbanked segment. And when 65 years later, we're still talking about financial inclusion. What is the problem with regulation that we've not been able to address that end? And we've not been able to let this end grow.
I think one of the things which maybe regulator has accepted the fact that there are too much companies to manage, and we do not have the bandwidth to manage those level of companies. Hence, today also, they have increased the value that beyond that, NBFC has an option to delist themselves. So they will be completely out of the regulator environment. They will not be regulated, they will not supposed to file any return and so on and so forth. So the point is, when we are talking about chit fund, this is again a huge number of companies we are talking about, nobody is regulating. So the regulatory aspect of the financial NBFC and similar level of companies initially started more as a part of registration. As they start growing, regulation started limiting to those then. And smaller companies going out.
Yeah, Hemal, do you want to talk about
it? I think, just want to add that what we need to factor in also the evolution phase of the regulators. What we miss out is today on one hand you have the RBI, the SEBI, who have been there, who are quite forceful. There are regulators in the power sector, for example, who are there worrying. There are new regulators coming who are learning the tricks of the trade. But the role is also changing. There was a time when honestly you didn't have people acting. And now you have a case where two regulators might even fight that this is my domain.
Correct.
You didn't see that 5 years back. You saw that, okay, if it's an insurance company raising some product which is insurance, or I also want to govern it, IRD also wants to govern. You didn't see that. You didn't see something where SEBI is saying that, hey, this is a collective scheme which is non-advertisement, okay, but I still want to govern it. I still want powers that I can attach something. So we also need to be cognizant that the environment in which we are operating is slightly different, with the regulators also becoming sharpening them.
You represent a big group, SR, and the one thing that I hear from a lot of the big corporate houses in India is that the regulation is unclear, there is no stability, we'd rather go overseas. And they have openly now said that increasingly, from the Sensex 30 or Nifty 50 companies, a large part of their revenue is coming from overseas. It's far easier to go overseas and grow rather than here. If you were to list out the regulatory uncertainties that are hurting you, what would they be?
In the context of India, where you are dealing with 1.2 billion people, and you are in the context of India, where you have a huge number of values to be organized and understood, in the context of India, where there is a difference of have and have nots and more, and you are relatively a younger economy, as you have said, there has to be some kind of regulation. From the SR perspective, we went to abroad not in terms of having a fear of regulatory issue, believe me. We went abroad in terms of our capability to manage certain things, in terms of our hardcore competencies. Like we went to Stanlow refinery because we are a refiner. We went to acquire certain mines because we need it. We went to have some steel plants in Canada, Minnesota, because we are steel planters. So issue from the perspective of HR is that you go abroad to seize and use your competencies for better opportunity. It's not that you fear regulation as such.
Sharish, you know, I think the fact that regulation is keeping pace with a rapidly evolving economy is a issue that we have to take into cognizance, because I think that's the crux of it. I don't think the intentions are wrong. It's really the time that it's taking. My question to you is that in the existing network, most regulators are ex-bureaucrats, you know, from that fraternity. Is it also time to have practitioners among the regulatory? The nature of the regulatory body also needs to be changing with more best practices, world knowledge, or do you think that that's something that we need to address?
The first regulator which sought to experiment with this notion was SEBI, when they took in somebody from the private sector to run a particular part of SEBI. And I think this is now going to come increasingly in other regulators. But there are three key points that we need to note. One is that in all our discourse, we forget for whom the regulation is being done, which is
for the people.
And that is what our Financial Services Regulatory Commission, which has just come out with a draft report, has put at the center of all change that must happen in India. The other thing that I'm noticing is that e-governance and the digitization of regulations, the visibility of the interplay of regulations is becoming very much more sort of transparent. So there is a separate e-governance company of India formed very recently, which has for its remit to enable this whole process of digitization in everything, in land records, in real estate, in gold, in life policies. Everything that represents wealth will ultimately have to get digitized. When you have that infrastructure, then you have the ability to see the impact of that regulation as it redounds to the benefit or is of an industry or a person for whom the regulation is being made, and you will knock off automatically things which are causing confusion. Because if there is a judgment which a particular tribunal has given or a particular regulator has given which has a impact on somebody else, then that will become visible to the system.
Sure.
So these are the three trends that I'm seeing, and India is working very hard.